Good afternoon, everybody. Let's stand and sing hymn number 538. Hymn number 538. See if we can get through it. That was a lot of food. But we'll sing the first, the third, and the fourth. Blessed be the name. Let's sing. Oh, who reigns above in majesty supreme, who gave his son for men to die that he might men redeem. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Redeemer, Savior, friend and man, once ruined by the fall, thou hast devised salvation's plan, for thou hast died for all. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. On the fourth, his name shall be the Counselor, the Mighty Prince of Peace, of all earth's kingdoms conqueror, whose reign shall never cease. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen. Well, amen. I tell you, your tummy is full, so it's going to be difficult to stay awake. So if you have to stand throughout the whole service, that's fine. Go ahead and do that. That is good to have you. Thank you so much for staying with us today. And we hope and pray that the early afternoon service will be a blessing to you. Let's go ahead and bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, thank you for all the day and all that has happened, the many visitors. And Lord, it's just been a great day. And Lord, I know that seeds were planted and hearts were stirred and a challenge no doubt went forth. And I just pray, Father, that your people were drawn closer to you. I pray, Lord, that you'll continue to work in our midst today as the service continues. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Well, it is good to have you today. I don't know about you, but I've thoroughly enjoyed the Barnett Trio. And it seemed like on some of your faces, you didn't know quite how to respond to the music. And so you'll have another opportunity to respond again, all right? It's all right to say amen. It's all right to raise your hand and say hallelujah. You know, it's okay. God won't get you. But I've asked them to, they're going to come back. They're going to come in at this time, and they're going to sing three songs. And then they'll a little bit later on sing two songs. And then Brother Bruce will come preach for us. But right now, the Barnett Trio.
Crown. Amen. It's a powerful, powerful message in those songs.
All right. We're going to take an offering, so ushers, let's come. I'm sorry, I just can't get over that last song. That's all. Amen. I normally don't need a snot rag, but I need one now. So, amen. No. It's all right. It's all right. All right. Well, obviously, we want to be a blessing to the Barnett Trio family, and we want to be a blessing to Brother Bruce. And so if you can give, sure would appreciate it. Let's go ahead and bow our heads. Brother Cross, why don't you lead us in a word of prayer? Amen. God bless you as you go.
Amen. Let's open our hymn books one more time to hymn number 25. Hymn number 25. We'll sing the first and the last. And this particular hymn has a very special place in my heart. We've sang it before, but I've never told you the story of why it has a special place in my heart. Might cry, so be warned. My grandfather from my mom's side was always an atheist. Never believed in God. About 10 years now, he had lupus and bone cancer, and my mom and I went to visit him. He was staying with his eldest children in Florida, and I'll get through it. Give me a chance. My mom's eldest siblings, from my grandfather's side, from her dad's side, they're Christians. But every single time they would bring their pastor over to just give him the word of God, he rejected it every single time. Every single time. Even when he couldn't speak, he didn't want that man. He would try to tell other people, I don't want that man near me. But my mom was particularly special to his heart. And my mom wouldn't, she shared the gospel with him, but she would always sing this song. And every time My mom went into the room. He would start humming this song. The wonder of it all. The wonder of God's love. That even in these verses, they say the most beautiful sunrise or the most beautiful sunsets don't compare to the love of God. When time passes, the love of God is eternal. And even though he didn't make an outward expression of faith, I still have hope that the message, the gospel, even the love of God reached his heart. That even on his deathbed, right before he died, he accepted Christ as a Savior. That is why this song is so close to my heart. Because it gives me hope that my grandfather accepted Christ as a Savior. Even though he rejected the man that brought him the gospel, through him, he understood the love of Christ. So let's sing. Even though that was a sad story, let's sing about the love of God. We'll sing the first and the last verses of The Wonder of It All. Let's sing. There's the wonder of sunset at evening. Is coming again. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. The wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think
about you, but my heart has been thrilled. My cup is running over for sure. And so the Barnett Trio is going to come one more time, and they're going to be singing two songs. And then after that, Brother Bruce will bring the precious word of God. So Barnett, thank you so much for being such a blessing today. And praise the Lord. Amen.
Well, they set me up for failure. First thing he said was, whatever you do, do it speedily. I've never preached speedily in my life. And then they get up here and just tear my heart right out from under me. I sure appreciate you all, what you brought to us today. If your heart's not full right now, you probably need heart surgery. Yeah, seriously, we'll schedule you for right after the service. You're in tough shape. I hate to go this way, but I'm going to do it anyhow. How many of you have noticed how high gas is? Yeah, Reva was telling me what our budget was for gas and that we were twice above it. And I said, well, you might want to change our budget. You know, we travel in a Honda Pilot SUV, but they travel in a bus. So can you imagine what gas alone costs them to get here, go home? And so, preacher, I would never take this liberty anywhere else, but I take it here because if Alan doesn't like it, Susan will tell him to shut up. It's my brother talking. There's CDs back there, right? I know what they do. I know that's how it supplements a little bit. Doesn't do a lot, but it supplements a little bit, them getting around. And if they get around and sing like they have sung here today, they're helping people. Amen? They're helping people. And so I hope you'll help them. Some of you need to get a little of that money out of your wallet anyhow. You're not going to die with it, right? If you die with it, it's going to stay in the wallet and your kids are going to steal it, you know? So bless them as you go out today. I think let them know that you really appreciate them being here. Hebrews chapter 11, where we were this morning, and I will try to be careful about the time, but I do want to say to you that one thing I've learned in preaching is that when God gives you a load, you need to deliver it. And I want to deliver this, and I'll do it as in proper timing as possible. But I think God has set up this service for exactly what the Lord has laid on my heart. Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 1 says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Now, Lord, we ask you to bless us. The singing has been so wonderful and so powerful. Lord, it'd be easy now to get lost in the delivery of a message here, but I pray that each and every one might just open their hearts up, be real receptive to the Word of God, and allow God to speak to them in these few minutes that we have together, and we ask it in Jesus' name, amen. In the morning service, I talked about the fact that the word faith is based upon substance, and we talked about what substance means, that substance, the word sub means under, and the word stance means where we stand, so substance, where we stand, and where we stand is important. We looked at that this morning. Now, amen right there, okay, because I want to wake you up, all right? Amen. I might do this, and that means amen, all right? So substance, that's where we stand. And where we stand makes a difference, and what we do with where we stand makes a big difference. And so we saw that substance is the foundation underneath our feet of the things of God. We learned this morning that the Jews were living, having a hard time because they were living in that post-Judaistic period in their life, and they were still wanting to do it their own way. And God reminds them that they needed to grow in the grace of God. They needed to grow in their faith. He reminded them, he said, let us go on unto perfection. In other words, on to maturity, growing in the things of God. And then he says in chapter 11, verse 1, now faith, that which we just talked about in chapter 10, that you received when you trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, is going to be the foundation of your walk with God. Substance, standing on what God would do in your life. Now, the next thing he says here, and it is the evidence of things not seen. Now, you and I know what the word evidence means. Evidence means an assimilation of facts that can be used to prove a matter in our life. I'll give you a simple real life illustration. Miss Reva and I were driving in Tampa, Florida, where I pastored. We were coming out of a bookstore, and as we came out of the bookstore, we saw that the traffic was coming to stop. There was a red light maybe 50 feet to our right or so, and then traffic was coming. They stopped. They saw me coming out. There were two lanes there, and as we exited across that traffic and turned left, a young fella in a little SUV came around and broadsided us. He had gone around the appropriate lane into the oncoming traffic and hit us, and it knocked Mrs. Turner completely out. In fact, for the first few minutes, I was just trying to make sure she was alive, and then a police officer arrived on the scene. Well, I'd been a chaplain in Tampa for 15 years, and he recognized me immediately. He said, "Chaplain, are you okay?" I said, "I am." I said, "My wife's, I'm not sure about her. She woke up, but her neck looked like it was broken. The airbag hit her right in the face, and her neck swelled up, and they were taking her to the hospital." He said, "Look, I'm going to have to ask you to stay. I'm going to give you a ticket." And I said, "You're going to give me a ticket?" And he said, "I'm going to give you a ticket." And I said, I hate to do that, but he said, "There's an obscure law here in Florida that says if you come off of private property and an accident ensues, it's your fault." I said, "Well, that's ridiculous." He said, "It is, but I got to give you a ticket." I said, "Well, you're going to have to do it at the hospital because I'm going with her to the hospital." So sure enough, he came to the hospital and gave me a ticket. And, you know, my police officer friend back here, he's trying to figure this one out. And so I said, well, I'll tell you what. I said, you're a good guy, but I will see you in court. And so I went home and I did what probably most people don't do. I read the law. And the law says if you come off of private property, you should immediately, that's a key word right there, amen, immediately, be able to ascertain any danger, and therefore the accident would be your fault. So I went to court, and guess what I did? I went downtown and I videoed that scene. I showed where the stoplight was. I showed where I came out. I showed the lanes that stopped. I showed where that young man had to come around those lanes. And I prepared evidence. And I said, "Your Honor," first of all, he got a big kick out of this. I said, "Your Honor, I'm asking you to drop the charges against me." He laid back in his seat and started to giggle. He said, "That's really good for a layman." He said, "I'm going to go ahead with the case." And I said, "Your Honor, I'm going to present some evidence to you." I presented it all to him. And he leaned back in his chair. He grabbed that gavel. My heart started to pound like this. He brought that gavel down and he said, "Not guilty." And my flesh really took over. And I looked at the attorney they had on the other side and kind of gave him a snotty little look, you know. Evidence did that, amen? Evidence did that. I said, "Your Honor, I did ascertain the immediate danger, and I stopped, and then they waved me out, and there was no danger available because both lanes were full and sitting there. The only danger was when this young man decided to make an illegal move and come around in the wrong lane of traffic and hit me, and that evidence caused him to find me not guilty." That's what evidence is. Evidence is important in our life. Amen. Now, the Bible said faith is the substance. That's what we stand on. But it is also the evidence of things not seen. Now, listen, God has given us his word. Amen. And in his word, we have evidence of what we believe. Am I right this afternoon? We have evidence of what we believe. Listen, I believe this morning in the eternality of God. I believe He was in the beginning. I believe God is the eternal, sovereign God of the universe. You know why I believe that? Because that's exactly what this Bible gives evidence to. Amen? I believe that He is the Creator that spoke everything into existence that exists. I believe that He is the one who did all kinds of miracles, that He healed the sick and He healed the blind, and He did whatever needed to be done in the physical healing of men and women and boys and girls. I believe He died vicariously on the cross. I believe He went to a grave. I believe on that resurrection morning He came up out of that grave, triumphant over the grave, triumphant over death, and triumphant over hell. And I'll tell you this afternoon, as tired as we are and as glycemic as we are, I want to say to you, I believe that He's coming again. Amen. And I believe that because I have evidence. Amen. Evidence that is given by the Word of God. We believe this morning, this afternoon, in the feeding of the 5,000. We believe in the healing of Jairus' daughter. We believe that the lame were made to walk. We believe that He said, "Peace, be still," and He calmed the sea. We believe that He took spittle and healed the blind. We believe that He raised Lazarus out of the grave. We believe that He turned the water into wine. Why? Because we have the evidence of the Word of God. And the Word of God teaches us that we can take God at His word. Now, I want to just give you two quick examples out of the Word of God. And that is believing God, look at me, because He said so. Just because He said so. Are you with me this afternoon? Come on, at least do this at me a minute. Make sure you're okay, making sure no one is in comatose here, all right? Two examples here in the Word of God that show me that these people that are listed in the Hall of Fame, they did what they did, not having any proof, tangible, physical proof. Rather, they simply took God at His word. Let's look at the first one in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse number 7. By faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world and became heir of righteousness, which is by faith. Can you imagine when God gave orders to Noah that there was going to be a flood? A what? A flood. That there was going to need to be a boat. A boat? What's a boat? That they were going to see water come up and form a flood. What's a flood? And that they were going to be there for many days, and that the whole earth was going to be consumed, and that there was going to be a great amount of death. But he and his family would find grace in the eyes of God. I don't know if in your mind you can get a picture of that, but I know how many times when God has brought challenges into my life, as they sang about a little while ago, that I've doubted God. I remember when we retired and things weren't so good for us, and I remember a moment of real weakness when I said, Brother, what is God going to allow next in our life? I remember my wife saying to me, "Get over it, just get over it." That's what she says to me about everything, "Just get over it." But my faith was shaken, and I'm wondering how in the world this can happen. And then I remembered what an old preacher said to me. He said, "Listen, when you get discouraged and you don't know what to do, and you begin to feel depression come into your heart, read the Word of God and read your way out of that discouragement." And I began to read, and guess what? As I began to read, I was reminded of Noah. Noah had no tangible physical evidence that there was going to be rain, something he hadn't seen. There was going to be a flood, something he hadn't seen. There was going to need to be this big boat. How many of you have gone down where Noah's Ark replica is? You've seen that. How many have gone down there? I'm really just a handful. It's worth looking at. Doesn't change my faith, but it sure makes me realize what a big old miracle it was. Amen? And I look at this miracle, and I thank God for someone like Noah that I can look back to, and I can imagine the confusion in his mind. Can you imagine for 120 years as he preaches and he's working away and maybe he's pitching within and without and everybody is laughing at him and mocking at him, but he went ahead and did what God called him to do because he had his feet, he had substance with God. God had proven himself to him, and he had evidence that everything God had said to him, God did. Amen? It provides evidence. I'm going to tell you, I think that's what the Bible means when it says the righteousness of God in our lives is revealed from faith to faith. One exercise of faith to the next exercise of faith to the next exercise of faith, to the next exercise of faith, our faith grows stronger because God proves himself to us and we have evidence that God takes care of his own. Amen. I give you a couple of quick illustrations of that. Some months back, you know, we live on Social Security and love offerings. And I didn't have a rich uncle. All of my uncles were drunkards and died. I never had anybody leave me an inheritance. We did have a lady put our name on an inheritance in New England, and about a year before she died, some man married her. We lost our inheritance, that old guy. I wanted to go beat him up. So we've never had money like that. You know what I'm talking about. Most of you here probably have had to work hard to make ends meet, right? I mean, we didn't have all those things. But I want to tell you, when we started out in evangelism, I learned what faith really meant. I thought I lived by faith. My grandson-in-law, pastor, is here, and my granddaughter and the kids, and I'm sure that he thinks he's living by faith, but he's living by salary. And I have news for you. It will come to an end someday. I just want to be a blessing to you. It will come to an end someday. But I'll tell you, I realized, man, I haven't been living by faith. Brother Jack, I've been living by salary. And when the salary was gone, I had to learn what faith really meant. And we began to trust God. I'll tell you, just this last week, you know, we had a friend call. And he's a pastor, and his wife, maybe four years ago, came down with Alzheimer's, and he had to resign from ministry because he needed to be with her. And he's been teaching school this year, and he called me and he said, "Brother Bruce, I just need to talk to you, and I just need some help and some counseling from you." He said, "I'm a preacher. I need to get back preaching. I don't know what to do." I said, "Well, let the kids help you with that. Get out and do some preaching." And he said, I just haven't had enough invitations to make ends meet. And my wife and I were praying for them after the phone call. And I said to my wife, "I think we ought to send X amount of dollars." And it's not, you know what it's like, taking X amount of dollars out of the budget that's already thin. And so we decided, yeah, we'll do it. My wife made out the check. We put it in the mail. And then that was on Monday. On Wednesday, the preacher that we were with, now hear this, a church that I think averaged maybe 12 for this revival meeting out in the country, a little country church, averaged about 12. And I fully expected we'd get an average offering of 12. I understand that, and we're good with that, by the way. And so the preacher calls me in the office Wednesday night, or out in the back of the auditorium, actually. He said, "I want you to sit down." Well, I was prepared for that. "Sit down, preacher. I'm going to tell you, you know, we've only got 8 people or 9 people coming to the meeting, and it's been a little tough this week. But that's not what he said. He said, "Preacher, I'm going to have to crawl down here, get my legs to work. I had a broken leg a year ago, and it's not working too good." He said, "Sit down. I need to show you something." And he said, would you open up your offering envelope? I hate to do that. I always put the offering envelope in my pocket and I walk away and we don't look at it intentionally till we get home or back to the hotel, because we don't live to get offerings. We live by the offerings, but we don't live to get them. And we serve the Lord whether we get them or not. And we get back. So he says, open it up. And we opened it up, and my jaw dropped down to my knees. It was the biggest single church offering we've ever gotten. It was astonishing. My wife said to me, it pays to serve God, doesn't it? She said, it pays when God says give, to give, doesn't it? And the evidence has come in our life that every time we do what God says, He will give us what we need in our life. Listen, Noah had no idea about these things God said, but they came to pass. Say amen right there. They came to pass, and God took care of them. God gave grace to them because they had substance. Their feet were upon their faith, and God gave them evidence in their life that they could trust God at every turn. Now listen, don't you sit there and act like Presbyterians to me. Come on, say amen now. Has God taken care of you? Come on, has God been good, as they just sang for us? Then we ought to give Him the glory for it. Thank Him for the evidence of things not seen, because we walk with God. And then the second one here, and lastly, Hebrews 11 and verse 17. By faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac, and he that had received the what? The promises. Hey, you know what the promises are? They're evidence. Amen. They are evidence that God is going to keep His word. And he that had received the promises offered up his only begotten son. Are you familiar with the story about Abraham and Isaac? How God sent them up onto the mountain. They saddled the ass. They took the wood. They went up onto the mountain. They even said to their servants, hey, just hang out here. That's my version of it. Just hang out here. We're coming back. How can you say we're coming back when God told you to take him up onto the mountain and offer him as a sacrifice? You know how you can say to the servants, stay here, we're coming back? Because the promises of God were clear in his mind, and the evidence was clear in his mind that God would provide himself to be a lamb. Amen. They get up on that mountaintop. When we come to Hebrews chapter 11, you know what the Bible teaches us? The Bible teaches us that Abraham offered Isaac. Even though he did not plunge that knife into the heart of his son, in his heart he had given obedience to God, because the promises, are you listening to me? The promises were clear evidence that he could trust God. Now, I don't know what the needs are in your heart this afternoon. I don't want to preach a long message, so I'm just going to give application here and ask you to think about this. What is it that God needs to do in your life? What is it you need to trust God to perform in your life? Can you trust Him? I say, number one, if you have the right stance, if your feet are on the faith in God and not in yourself, God will provide promises. Those promises are the evidences that He's done it before, amen, and He'll do it again. Has He done it before in your life, church? Has He done it before? Has He over and over and over blessed you as they sang that song? I'm just going to be honest with you. I can't hardly walk right now, but I wanted to just run around this auditorium and jump a couple of pews, and if there were chandeliers I could reach, I'd swing off of those to think of the goodness of God in my life. I'm telling you, some of you, you're almost asleep from sugar, but I want to tell you, you need to wake up long enough to rejoice in the Lord. God's been good to you, and He's given you the things that you need in your life because your feet have been on faith in Him, and He's provided evidence that even though you don't see where it's going to come from, God's going to do it. Amen. You know what I love about this chapter? All of these miracles God said they all died in faith, having not seen the promises. What about that? But they knew they could die still believing, because their faith wasn't in their own works. It wasn't in what they thought they could work out and make it happen. Their faith was in the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and on and on. They believed that believing and trusting God, He'll do what He said He will do. Amen. I just want to tell you, as a 72-year-old preacher who's been preaching 55 years coming November, God's never let us down. He'll never let you down. He'll never let the singers down. His promises are real. I want to encourage you today. If your feet aren't firmly in faith, standing on the foundation of God's promises, tell Him today, Lord, I'm going to trust You like I've never, ever trusted You before. Faith is the substance, the foundation of things hoped for, and the evidence that even though you haven't seen it, God will perform it in your life. Amen? Would you stand with me, please? I'm just going to ask Miss Bethany if we could just have a couple of verses of invitation on the piano. And maybe today you've been struggling to just take God at His word. And maybe you ought to just come here to the altar and say, Lord, I've been struggling, but I want to trust You and I want to believe You. Forgive me for my unbelief. Thank You for the evidences of the past that helped me to know that You're going to meet every need that I have. May God help you today if you need to come. Our Father, we pray You touch hearts now in this moment of invitation. We won't be long. So, Lord, I pray if folks need to come, they'd come even as the piano begins to play now. In Jesus' name, amen. As the piano plays, would you come? Would you come? Is there something God spoke to your heart about? Is there something you're struggling with, trying to trust God for? How about trusting Him? I think church people, I'm not trying to impress anybody. I'm not going to give a report on how many came to the altar or didn't come to the altar. But I think maybe our churches need to loosen up and start getting to the altar and saying, Lord, I've not trusted You like I ought to trust You, but I want to trust You. I want to trust You. How about it? Would you come? We'll tarry just a moment. Pastor will come and dismiss us. Still time to come. Maybe right there in your seat, you could just say, Lord, I've been struggling with my faith. I want to trust You more than I ever have before. Give me the strength to take You at Your word. Oh, I know about those trials. I know about worrying where the next week comes from, or the next month comes from, where the next mortgage comes from. When you're flirting with 300,000 miles on your car and you're wondering where the next car is going to come from. Yeah, I understand all that. I'll just tell you, the evidence is that even though I don't know how and you don't know how, God does know how. Amen? He does know how. Preacher, would you come?
Folks, the challenge is to you and I as Christians who know the Lord. May we learn to step out by faith. May we learn to trust Him by faith. We're going to sing a verse of hymn. You do what God would have you to do. Come on as we sing. Oh, it's been a great day, folks. It really has. But I hope it has not just gone in one ear and out the other. That it leaves an impression on our lives. Aren't you tired of just going through the motions? We want our faith to be real. We want our relationship with God to be alive and well. And challenge has gone forth. The message has gone. What about it? I believe we are without excuse. God has been so good to us. And I hope and pray that as the Lord says, all right, church, follow me, that we will by faith. No matter what we are confronted with, no matter what this generation, whatever we have to deal with, God's looking for a church that will just simply rise up and follow him. Amen. In faith. Not like the culture and nothing like that. But we need to love the Lord. And we need to trust him. And God knows what he's doing. And I tell you, I don't know about you, but it's been a blessed day. I think more so to the people of God than anything else. I think it really has been a blessing. Barnett Trio, sure is good to see you again. And I think your wife is a blessing. Amen. Praise the Lord. It was nice to meet you. And Sadie, I tell you, bless the Lord. And you too. All right. So, but anyway, it's always a blessing to have Brother Bruce here. And he's always an encouragement and a challenge. And amen. Amen for that. Brother Bruce, why don't you make your way, you and your lovely wife.
Can I just say one quick thing? Back here with Mary is Mr. Hall. That's Ed's son. Yep. And we used to babysit him when he was about 10. And he was bold enough to show up to hear me preach today. Amen. Thank you, brother, for coming. It was a blessing seeing you.
Yeah, he came here because he didn't want Mary to be alone today. So that was the reason why. So, no, amen. Well, I tell you, it has been a great day in the house of the Lord. And I hope you go home full, not only physically, but obviously, spiritually. And so, Brother Bruce, folks, why don't you go out to your table out there. And now, church, if you have brought a dish of food, we want you to take your dish and your food home with you. Okay? Please check that. Is it in the kitchen? In the hallway. It's in the hallway. So please take your dishes home. And I don't know about you, but did you enjoy the trio? Amen. Maybe we could have them back, maybe?
Yeah.
All right. Great. I don't know about Bruce, but we'll at least have the trio. But no, just kidding. Well, there is a pastor friend that's in our midst today. Brother Hargis, it's good to have you and your family here today. Don't you have services tonight? Well, bless your heart. Would you mind coming and dismissing in prayer? He pastors the Solid Rock Baptist Church in, I believe it's Pendleton, Indiana. And Caitlin is Brother Bruce's granddaughter. And so, but anyway, it's good to have you here today. Thank you for being with us. God bless you for the service tonight. We're done after today. All right. So.
Well, maybe I'll just hang out with you guys. No, I think I'm supposed to preach. Well, sweet church and sweet spirit here. God's doing a great work and has for many years, and I don't think he's done. Amen. So let's keep on being faithful. Let's go ahead and pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for what you continue to do at the Northern Park Baptist Church. Lord, I thank you for the many guests that were here this morning, and I thank you for the sweet spirit amongst the church. The tremendous messages and songs. God, it has been so good to be a part of this church today. Lord, we ask that you would continue to do a great work in our midst. We'll give you all the glory for it. May you continue to reach souls in this community. And to you be all the glory, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.